round, round, get around.
I get around.
Yeah,
get around, round, round. I get around.
I get around. Where the kids are hip. My buddies and me, you're getting real well known. Yeah, the bad guys know us and they leave us alone. I get around,
round, 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 round. I get around.
Well, Gus, let's take a little walk if we can around the kitchen, and maybe you could show us a little tour of the house. And
all right.
We'll talk a little bit more about John Greenleaf Whittier.
Well,
we're standing in front of the hearth that was mentioned in the poem Snowbound. Maybe you could tell us what some of the accoutrements are here with the spinning wheel, and we've got some kitchen utensils, and there's a gun as well as a watch, and maybe you could give us a little explanation of those.
Be glad to. This is the most famous hearth in all of American literature because of Snowbound, because the Whittier family was actually here in 1818, and the fire was roaring. And over here, the right-hand side, this is their oven.
For baking.
Yep. But when students come here, I always ask them what they think this is. This is called a peel, but the students think this is for pizza.
Do they?
Not for baking bread. So I have to show them that this goes very far. And it's a beehive oven.
Yep.
It widens it.
Mm-hmm.
So lots of bread. Baked in there. And it got its heat from here, and if they wished, they could open this section underneath and put some hot coals in so it would get the heat from below, too. This was his mother's flax wheel, and this was used during that storm in 1818. His mother was using this flax wheel. This is a great piece. This is...
The cover comes up.
Yeah, the cover comes up. But in the back, I'll turn it around and show you how smart they were.
It's all open.
It's all open. It's an open oven. A rotisserie, but they called it a reflecting oven. And they didn't have to have someone sitting here cranking it. They have little holes on the side.
I notice.
They would just put one here and let it cook that way for a while, and then just keep on moving and keep on moving. And this would be facing the fire, like this, and they just use this to see how things were
cooked. Chicken or whatever.
Yes. That's a great piece. It's made of tin, too. So every night I have to make sure it's placed in the proper place.
Right.
I don't want anything to happen. In Snowbound, we have apples sputtering in a row.
Right.
So we have apples on top of these pegs.
And that's how they did it.
That's how
they
did it.
They took a log, put wooden pegs in, and popped the apples on top.
Popped the apples on top and put it in front of the open fire. And pretty soon they were.
Sputtering
in a row. And we have the pot crane. And this is vegetables for stew, all kinds of things. But
Gus, what's this utensil called?
This is fantastic. Made of iron, it weighs 35 pounds, and it's for boiling water. But they were very smart. They don't have to lift this up. They would just fill it, pot crane over, heat it up, bring it back out, and then they would just hold it, this piece, and hold the mug down here, and just pour.
Hot water comes out.
Hot water comes out for their tea.
Just like that. Don't have to lift it. Don't have to get burned.
No, no. That was a great piece. Over here, this is what the kids love most of all.
Toast?
For toast. This is the toaster. This is a great toaster. Right in front of the fire. And then you bring it out and turn it around. And toast the other side. Kids love the story of that.
Do most of the kids guess that that's a toaster when you show it to them, Gus?
No.
Yeah.
One boy tried to convince me that it was for cooking eggs.
Yeah.
That would never work.
Right.
Never work. And right behind the door here, we have an 1817 old farmer's almanac.
Great.
1817. That was the almanac that predicted the storm.
And he was born in 1807.
1807. He's so 10 years old.
10 years old.
Yes.
Isn't that amazing? With the prediction of that massive storm.
Yes, in the storm that was coming. And that big mug up here,
mm-hmm.
that was here in 1818, filled with cider.
With cider.
And it was over at the oven, warming up.
Right.
And then it was just passed around. The family all had nice, warm sips of cider.
Yeah.
And these pieces up here belong to Uncle Moses. Uncle Moses was the poet's father's brother.
Mm-hmm.
Uncle Moses lived here. When John Greenleaf Whittier lived here. And he was the hunter, he was the fisherman, he taught the poet a lot about nature.
Mm-hmm.
He was the one, and that was his bullseye watch too, Uncle Moses.
His watch.
Yes. So this is the famous hearth. Just before we have Snowbound every year, I get sent outside to round up all the hickory nuts.
The hickory nuts.
So I have to beat the squirrels. To the punch. And we do roast these during Snowbound.
Now I was noticing, Gus, the wood.
Yes.
Wide planks, very wide planks,
yes.
Because it was early cut lumber.
Oh, yes.
And the trees in those days were much wider.
Oh, yes.
As they cut them. Look
same
at the floor.
As the floor.
Sure.
White pine.
Mm-hmm.
White pine since 1700. This is the 1700 room.
Mm-hmm.
And the others are the 1688 rooms.
Mm-hmm.
And at one time, after they built this room, this was a salt box. Gradually that was lifted off and they built more rooms above.
Second floor.
So it has changed a number of times.
So here we are in the second kitchen.
Yes.
Really?
This is the second kitchen.
Okay. Whittier Homestead.
And they needed this for 12 people.
Mm-hmm. You know, you had mentioned the writing of the poem, Snowbound, and you also mentioned that this is where he wrote his first poem that he submitted to William Lloyd Garrison.
Yes.
Maybe we'll take a look at the desk where he wrote that poem.
Oh, the desk is right over here.
Okay.
This was his grandfather's desk, Joseph II. And the poet actually wrote the final version of The Exile's Departure.
Mm-hmm.
It was about an Irishman leaving Ireland to come to America.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of a strange poem for a Quaker to be writing.
Right.
And the first one that was published, it was in William Lloyd Garrison's Newburyport Free Press. And this is the poem that was sneaked out of here
by his sister
Mary, because she thought it was terrific. And the next week, when the newspaper arrived,
Lo and behold,
there it is. And Greenleaf knew nothing about it.
Oh, she didn't?
She hadn't told him.
Oh.
So Uncle Moses was the one who got the paper that day.
Mm-hmm.
Greenleaf hadn't signed it, John Greenleaf Whittier. Mm-hmm. Hadn't signed Whittier at all. Had this strange W.
Mm-hmm.
So Uncle Moses, is this your W, Greenleaf? And Greenleaf walked over to him in this room,
mm-hmm.
and said, that's my poem. He didn't know how it ever got into the newspaper. And then his sister Mary owned up to what she had done. So it's a good thing she did that for us.
Yeah, she really got him into the publication of his literary masterpieces.
With the abolitionist.
Sure.
William Lloyd Garrison.
So there's the first connection.
Oh, yes.
You know, there's another connection, William Lloyd Garrison. There's a statue of him in Newburyport, Garrison Square. But there's another statue, and it's something that bothers me to this day. It is in Park Square in Boston. There's a statue of the liberation of the slaves. And it used to be in one location near the, I think it's the Four Seasons Hotel. It was a little park, and it was sitting there by itself. And on the bottom of that statue in Park Square in Boston was a quotation of John Greenleaf Whittier having to do with the liberation of the slaves and the ending of slavery. And on the bottom, in large raised letters, was the quote, John Greenleaf Whittier. Now, at some point, the city of Boston moved that statue, put a little bit of a grassy area around it as part of a renovation, and they have since covered over the quote and John Greenleaf Whittier's name with dirt and grass. Oh. Maybe it's something we could look into in the future.
Oh, that would be interesting.
Because I remember walking by probably 25 years ago, Park Square in Boston, being from Haverhill, knowing about Whittier, seeing the quote, saying to myself, well, that's pretty good. Quote about John Greenleaf Whittier, here it is in Boston, in a prominent part of the city. Mm. So the statue's there, Gus. The quote's been covered by dirt as they raised it up.
I would love to go there.
Find out about
that. Look into this.
There's another quote, John Greenleaf Whittier in the city of Boston. Technically, it's in Cambridge. Mount Auburn Cemetery, which goes back to the 1800s. John Bullfinch is interred there. I think Longfellow's interred there, among other notable people. But on a building in Mount Auburn Cemetery, there is a quote above a window, cut out of stone. And the quote's by John Greenleaf Whittier, and his name is in stone at Mount Auburn. So his poems not only are everywhere, but they're everywhere in stone from the writing. Yeah. Now, I noticed, Gus, that when people come to visit the homestead, you've got a visitor's register. And I was taking a look at it, and just for example, for this year in 2010, you've had visitors from Ocala, Florida. Maybe we could talk in a minute about May 23rd in York, Nebraska, Mechanicsburg, Pennsylvania, San Jose, California, Clifton Park, New York, Asheville, South Carolina, Tallahassee, Florida, Williamsburg, Virginia, and Portsmouth, New Hampshire. And maybe you could tell us about your visitor from Portsmouth recently.
Oh, the visitor from Portsmouth. She was originally from Kentucky. Mm-hmm. And she came this way to see her grandchildren grow up, so now she's living in Portsmouth. Mm-hmm. But she knew about John Greenleaf Whittier as an abolitionist, and one of the Whittier Club members brought her here yesterday, and we had about a three-hour visit. It was very interesting. We had a lot of fun going through the home. She was very interested in everything that was going on, and people come from other countries. Last summer, they came from Seoul, South Korea.
And I believe there was a filming here maybe about 2 or 3 years ago. Wasn't it a Korean film crew?
Yes. They were students mm-hmm. with their professor, and they had come from South Korea, and they all had their cameras, their video.
Right.
And
it was like their version of public television.
That's right. They didn't tell me that until we were finished, mm-hmm. and it was kind of funny at the end. I had told them that I had portrayed John Greenleaf Whittier for his 200th birthday,
right.
and it had taken me 4 months
to grow,
to grow the beard. And so when they were leaving, they said, the professor said to me, and I wish you another 200 years. Yeah. But he told me that what they had done here in the birthplace was going to be shown on the South Korea's version of our PBS.
That's pretty amazing.
So the professor said to me, you're going to be an international hero.
Yeah.
So it's funny.
The number of people here, and the thing is, a lot of people take for granted what's in our own backyard. Mm. Here we are in Haverhill.
Yes.
So I just read a list of some of the cities from across the United States, but I was here about 4 years ago, and coming up the back walk was a couple from Ireland. Knew the accent as soon as the woman spoke, started talking to her. How is it you're here? She says, well, we read John Greenleaf Whittier growing up in high school. She said, that is why I am here today. So she came from Ireland. She was in the United States. It was one of her destinations. But maybe you could talk a little bit about, for those that aren't aware of Whittier's significance, not only in the literary world, but also academia. You've had groups here from colleges and ones from Nebraska recently, right?
Yes, we just had York, Nebraska, mm-hmm. Four faculty members and over 20 students. They came the same day we had
the Haverhill Cultural Treasures program.
Yes, with the trolleys.
Right.
And so when I finished my trolley ride, I had to get back here. I had the, I didn't actually thumb, but I asked for a ride because they dropped me off at the firefighting museum.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they were waiting for me here.
Yeah.
They had been to Concord, mm-hmm. and they had to come here. They wanted to be in the home of the famous abolitionist.
And also Calvin College.
Yes.
And that's Minnesota, I believe?
Yes, and they come every year.
Every year to the Whittier homestead.
Yes.
not only do they just come here, they sit here and they have classes right here. Mm-hmm. And I just sit on the side after I give the tour, mm-hmm. and I just listen to them, and it's wonderful. Yeah. The whole day they stay here.
The fact is, although he died in the late 1800s, John Greenleaf Whittier, through his poetry and his writings and his abolitionist writings in particular, he still lives. He's very much alive in this place.
Oh, very much alive. Yeah. And we tried to get the children interested, the trustees of the mm-hmm. Whittier Club. They pay for the children to come here.
From the Hagel school systems?
All the fifth grades are mm-hmm. welcome to come. Mm-hmm. And I found it difficult when they would arrive with not much
background.
So I go into the schools now and I have 80-minute periods. Mm-hmm. And I bring lots of things that Mr. Donald C. Freeman gave me to show the kids. And when they come here, I just give them the tour because they've already done a little bit about John Greenleaf Whittier, mm-hmm. his abolitionist poetry, and Snowbound, and In School Days, and mm-hmm. lots of others.
You know, behind you, maybe we could take a look before we do the tour. We've got a portrait of Elizabeth Hussey Whittier that goes from 1815 to 1864. Maybe you could talk a little bit about Elizabeth and her... It's like a sketch or a lithograph almost. Maybe.
It's a lithograph, yes. Elizabeth was a poet also. Mm-hmm. And in Snowbound, she's called his dearest. They were both poets, and mm-hmm. they were both abolitionists.
Right.
Both secretaries of the Anti-Slavery Society. Mm-hmm. And both worked with the Underground Railroad because mm-hmm. the Amesbury home was a safe house.
A stop on the Underground Railroad.
Yes, and from there they would go to Newburyport, mm-hmm. get on boats, and go to Nova Scotia, where they would be free. Mm-hmm. So Elizabeth was an excellent poet, and John Greenleaf Whittier, her brother, loved her very much. Mm-hmm. She was very frail most of her life. And she died many years before he died.
Right, about 20 years.
Yes.
Mm. Our youngest and dearest. And there's another sketch, and maybe we could get that on camera too.
This over here is Abigail Hussey Whittier, his mother. Mm-hmm. And in everything I have ever read about her, she was as wonderful a person as could possibly be. She loved her children, did all kinds of things, and tried to get them to do the best that they could in whatever way they wished to travel. So she was not like her husband in a way. Her husband needed John Greenleaf Whittier on the farm.
Needed the help.
Yes.
She encouraged him to follow his talent or his dream, I suppose.
And so she was very helpful that way. And up here on this wall, we have the catalog of the first class that ever attended Haverhill Academy in 1827. John Greenleaf Whittier was one of the students. He went for half a year. He ran out of money, but came back to finish his 1 year of high school, and that was it. That's as far as he went in school. But what is important here is most of these students, there were 100 students. 100 students in 1827, more female than male. And they came from distances. There's a student from New Orleans and New York City. They came from Marblehead. They came from Upper New Hampshire, Upper Vermont, 1827. And some of them were very good friends. Mr. Whittier had a cousin in the same class, Albert Whittier, who stayed with his father's home, Warner Whittier. And Warner became a mayor of Haverhill. This is great to have, not only for the names of the students, but also for the names of the families with whom they lodged. One of these girls in the class, Evelina Bray, Mr. Whittier was smitten with her for a while, but she was from Marblehead, and her family had lots of money. And the poor Quaker, John Greenleaf Whittier, he didn't have lots of money at the time, so her family put an end to that romance. But when Mr. Whittier was old, he was down in Philadelphia at a meeting, and when the meeting was over, his friend said to him, "Did you realize who was sitting on our bench with us? And he said, no, it was Evelina Bray Downey. She had married and moved to Philadelphia. Mr. Whittier found out where she lived. They stayed in touch, and her letter to him was the last letter he ever received before he died. Evelina Bray Downey. She would even come up to Haverhill to visit during the summertime, and sometimes went as far as Ossipee, because John Green of Whittier loved Ossipee. So this is a very valuable piece of information. And this is a contribution box. We no longer use this, but it has a very great quote on it. It says, "Sir, poetry will not bring him bread. This is what the poet's father, John, said to William Lloyd Garrison when William Lloyd Garrison wanted the poet to continue school so he could become a great poet. Little did the poet's father know that his son was going to be a very rich man.
As a result of poetry in his writings."
Exactly.
As you said, $10,000 for Snowbound.
Well, that's just the first printing.
Sure.
It went up to $100,000 over the years. A lot of money.
So this is the contribution box that's been here in this homestead ever since.
Ever since. Since this opened in, since 1893, when this became a museum.
A year after
he died.
It's been a museum for over 100 years.
Yes.
And there's another sign, I'm just reading it, Gus, that says, "Notice, offerings of visitors placed in this box aid in the care of this homestead as there are no adequate funds for the purpose." Which is true. It's based solely on volunteers.
Yes.
People making donations to keep this house going, because there are no government funds or other sources of revenue other than what the trustees try to raise.
It's nice that we are still continuing
the legacy.
Yes. Long time ago. And there's a man who was fantastic with this home, Donald C. Freeman.
And what we'll do later on is we're going to take a walk on Donald C. Freeman's trail and talk about him as we take that walk.
That would be super.
Sure. Gus, this is a picture from 1890 of the homestead. We'll be taking a walk outside shortly, but maybe you could talk a little bit about this photo.
This photo was taken 2 years before the poet died.
Mm-hmm.
He was no longer living here.
Right.
But it looks very good here. There was talk that Mr. Whittier was interested in buying it back before he had the stroke and died shortly afterwards in 1892. He had gone by it a number of times looking it over, but he didn't have the time to buy it back. So this is an old, old picture, 1890, of the birthplace where John Greenleaf Whittier was born.
There's another photograph of the Whittier homestead taken prior to 1903. The reason we know it was taken before 1903 is in that year there was a significant fire that almost destroyed this home. The fire luckily was stopped before the entire home was engulfed, and we'll show you a photograph of the fire results in 1903. But this photograph shows you the house before the fire. The next photograph shows you what the house looked like after the fire in 1903. Now, at that time, the home had been purchased by the trustees of the Whittier Homestead, and it was a museum. And luckily, many artifacts and pieces of furniture were removed and saved before the Haverhill Fire Department arrived to put the fire out. But very few people are aware of the fact, as you can tell from the photograph, that there was a significant destructive fire at the Whittier Homestead in 1903. They've done a remarkable job of restoring it as we take a walk through the house. Standing here with a visitor, Richard Hyde, who came up today from Providence, Rhode Island, to the John Greenleaf Whittier Homestead. You're originally from North Carolina?
That's correct, yes.
Maybe, would you tell us why it is that you happened to come up to Haverhill today to see the Whittier Homestead?
I intended to do some hiking in the area. I was on my way to Amesbury, but I knew of the Whittier Homestead being in this area and decided to stop. I know that Whittier lived as an adult in Amesbury, where I had a number of relatives at one time. And so I just, and so, you know, I have an interest in Whittier for that reason, his connection to Amesbury, and his, yeah, and also the, you know, his abolition, you know, his involvement in abolitionism.
So it's just a great coincidence that Gus happens to be taping a program with me today, so maybe he could show you a little bit about this room, which was the original First Kitchen. Maybe he could tell us about this room, Gus.
Certainly.
Thanks for joining us today, Ray.
It's sure. Nice to have you here.
Yeah.
And I see it says Heidelberg, Germany. My grandfather came from Frankfurt on the Main.
Ah, yes.
This is the First Kitchen. This was too small for 12 people. But this was built in 1688. This was their first hearth. Very, very small. Nothing like the hearth in the main kitchen. These pieces were used by his mother and his grandmother. And when I first took this job, they said, when you're not busy, put on a pair of white gloves and take those out one piece at a time and dust them and then wash them and put them back. So I said, well, who did they belong to? And they said, well, those are his mother's and his grandmother's. So I said to myself, I'm not touching those. I'm liable to drop one. But look what they had in store for me. After you get finished doing those, you can then do these.
The full set.
The full set, all Whittier.
All
made
Whittier.
In this country, made in England, and made in other countries in Europe. I didn't touch any of those. The women in the Whittier Club, they washed those. I washed the windows.
Okay.
The windows. All right. But right over here, oh, I don't know if I can go right over there.
Yep, you can. We'll just...
This is the bust of Mr. Whittier. It's very, very heavy on a piece that is not very strong. This concerns me. I wouldn't want this falling on anyone. But this portrait is the newest portrait of John Green of Whittier. It's only 2.5 years old. And it was done by a Copley master.
And I know who painted it because I know his style, Mark Hayden of Haverhill.
That's correct. Mark Hayden did that when we had a wet paint auction here. And the trustees liked it so much that they decided to buy it and put it in the birthplace.
Terrific likeness of the bust.
Yes, it is. It's very good. But when I bring people in here, Jay, I say that that's Mr. Whittier's face. But that's my beard, because I sat for Mark Hayden when he painted that.
That painting? Did you use your beard?
But he just used my beard, you know, for the light and the dark, that
sure.
was all. But it's kind of funny that I was involved with that. Now, Richard,
yes.
In 1903, they had a fire here. Upstairs, lost the room, but it was redone the way it had been built. In 1688, but this, what we see here, is damage from the water. I don't know how the whole house was saved, because fire apparatus in 1903.
It was horse-drawn.
Oh, horse-drawn. A long time, a long way out, but luckily saved the house. So we're lucky to be standing in this room, the first kitchen. All of these pieces of furniture, every piece of furniture is Whittier furniture in this room. Every piece.
How about that ceiling, Gus? It's covered with plexiglass.
Yes, they figured that it would be better to do that. This is a result of the fire where the water was coming through from the second floor down.
Mm-hmm.
But they decided to put that up instead of trying to restore it, because maybe other pieces would start falling.
Mm-hmm.
And this way you can see what is between the first floor and the second floor.
Sure.
So that's nice that it's up there that way.
This brings to the end another edition of I Get Around. I want to thank my guest, our guide, Gus Roush, for giving us a wonderful walking tour of the Whittier birthplace. And Richard Height, who happens to be here from Providence, Rhode Island, came up today to take a look at the Whittier birthplace. Richard, I hope you enjoyed what you saw.
I did.
And Gus, what a great story. This life and the whole story of John Greenleaf Whittier, his family, and this fascinating piece of history in Haverhill, Massachusetts. Thank you again for a fascinating tour. A lot of interesting stories.
You're welcome. Nice to see you again, Jay.
Thanks very much, Richard.
Nice to meet you.
The trip. For I Get Around, I'm Jay Cleary, and I'll see you the next time I get around.
Round, round, get around, I get around,
yeah,
get around, round, round, I get around,
I get around.
Where the kids are hip. My buddies and me, you're getting real well known, yeah.